Maybe it's because I've screwed up so much in my life, I don't know. But what I do know is that this is not about me. It's about Leora, I think.
I've been to your lectures, Mr. Walsch, and I read your book about how God is this friendly God and the universe is a friendly place.
And you don't believe that?
I believe your God is a vengeful God. I adopted my son when he was 6 months old because I was told I could never have children. And we never told Jimmy that he was adopted until he was old enough to understand what that meant. At 14, we decided it was time. His grades fell off. His whole attitude changed. I mean, he got in trouble at school. It was a big mess. And he was angry at his mother for giving him up. He was angry at us for telling him. And he was angry at everything in his life. The only way to calm him down was to promise that when he turned 18, we would find his mother. No matter the cost, no matter how long it took, we promised him that he would get to meet his mother.
And
on Jimmy's 18th birthday, he was killed on a motorcycle. A drunk driver killed my Jimmy. So please enlighten me on your definition of a friendly God, Mr. Walsch, because I don't see a friendly God putting parents who love their son unconditionally through something like this. What does your God say now, Mr. Walsch?
If God had one message that he could tell us all, what was that message?
You've got me all wrong.
You've got me all wrong. Now, what does that mean?
Well, you know, it's an enormously powerful statement. You've got me all wrong is, in fact, God's five-word message to the world, and it causes us to sit and ponder. We have to, that statement, people have been asking me for a long time, what is God's message to the world? And when they ask it, they usually have something different in mind in terms of their expectation with regard to my answer. They're waiting for me to say something like, love is all there is, or be kind to each other, or whatever we think God would say to us if he had one or two sentences in which to get it out. But in fact, God's statement is much more direct and to the point. You've got me all wrong. You guys don't really understand. And it's okay that you don't understand. It's not an indictment, but just to acknowledge you don't really understand who I am, what's going on, the purpose of life, or any of the deeper, you know, interactive meanings between the divine and the rest of the universe, which is all the same thing. So here's the point of that, or here's the intriguing part about that statement, you've got me all wrong. If it's true that we have God all wrong, it requires any thinking person to say, well, then what would be right? What would be accurate? What's the full and total truth about this? That reopens the discussion. A discussion which has been closed for a very, very long time. Because organized religion and other branches of the wider branches of theology, to a large degree, have closed off the discussion. They tend to involve themselves in talks and discussions and explorations of what is already known. And sometimes deep talks and deep discussions. I've been involved in panel discussions and exploratory weekends, but we're always discussing the body of knowledge that already exists. But very few theologians and virtually no religionists will talk about, is it possible there's something we don't know yet or do not fully understand that we could add to this body of knowledge? Is it possible that there's something we do not fully embrace, the embracing of which could change everything? See, that's a new notion. And what we're inviting religion to do in this day and age through the Conversations with God dialogue is to consider what could occur if that conversation itself, not the conversation with God, but the conversation about God, could be broadened and enlarged to include notions we have not previously considered seriously or embraced in any kind of consistent way. And if that conversation was enlarged, what might we discover? You see, I want to make one final point, if I might. Religion has failed to do the one thing that technology and medical science and science itself has been very willing to do, and that is question the prior assumption. The reason we've made such extraordinary advances, breathtaking advances in medical science, for instance, to use just one field of endeavor or technology that we noticed in the studio, we were talking before we went on the air about the technology here.
Right.
The reason we've made those advances is because we've been willing to say, with regard to that which we already know, You know, that might be, in fact, the whole truth. But what if it wasn't? Can we question the prior assumption? Can we build on our already existing body of knowledge? And can we come from a place where we're willing to say, what if that wasn't all there is to know about this? It might be all there is to know, but what if it wasn't? Like Joan Rivers, you know, can we talk?
Right.
and now, but in religion, that discussion is often not only discouraged, but actually prohibited. I mean, if you bring up those kinds of questions in certain places and in certain nations, you can actually be brought up on charges of apostasy and killed. I mean, put to death for even suggesting that there might be something incomplete or something more to know on this subject. So I think that what religion needs to do and what people need to do is to begin questioning the prior assumption and to ask a fundamental question. Yeah. Is it possible there is something we don't know about God?
Well, even Jesus himself said, above all else, get thee understanding. And the man himself says that.
That's exactly right. And that's the beauty of this movie.
Right.
Not to get it back to the film, but I want you to understand that the film addresses itself to all those things I've just talked about without talking about it. I mean, without preaching about it, without nailing it right on the head. But film and filmatic artistry is a marvelous vehicle by which all that I've just said, you know, questioning the prior assumption, looking at is there something we don't fully understand, all that's done through the magic of storytelling. Mm-hmm. Without anyone having to sit down and describe it as I've just described it, you watch the movie and you get the whole thing by just watching, because the movie does that. The movie does question the prior assumption. The movie does ask the question and provide a possible answer. Is there something we do not fully understand? So you sit there and you watch this through the magic of storytelling and the genius of people like this man over here, and suddenly you get all that I've just done here in a very dry conversation with you in the exciting form of magical filmmaking and magical storytelling.
You have a broken neck.
You're 3 months behind on your rent. Isn't there someone you can call?
No, those calls were made a long time ago.
Within every one of us, there is a voice that speaks the truth.
Please, God.
I just want my life back.
Are you ready now? Do you really want to know the answers?
But all we need to do is listen.
What are you having me type? It's amazing.
It's like I'm just standing by. I'm just taking dictation. Like, I can't stop.
Well, you're about to become a published author.
We are prepared to offer you $1 million.
Check, please.
Oh, my God.
My God, too.
From the best-selling author, Neale Donald Walsh, comes a true story of love and inspiration.
I think your book could change the world.
When someone enters your life seemingly from nowhere and you wonder how you ever got along without them,
that is God.
Conversations with God.
I've really enjoyed getting to delve into the not only your minds but also your hearts. And so thanks everyone for watching again. I'm Tamara Henry and this is In, because of course it's the only way out. See you next time.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
It was fun. Oh, I bet you thought the show was over. Well, not just yet. I have to tell you, if you want to read more about Conversations with God and Neale Donald Walsh and Stephen Simon, pick up an issue of the Beverly Hills Times magazine from the past. It was from the October 2006 issue. Have a little article in there called Lights, Camera, Action. It's a little article on spiritual entertainment. And coming up on our next episode of In, we're going to have Malika Chopra, who actually produced Deepak Chopra's book, The Seven Spiritual Laws of Success, into another spiritual cinema. So make sure that you look for that one on the next episode of In. We're going to tell you the story behind the story. There's a little synchro destiny. You won't want to miss that one on the seven spiritual laws of success. See you next time. Bye-bye.
God had a face. What would it look like and would you want to see? If seeing meant that you would have to believe in things like heaven and Jesus and the saints and all the prophets.